Welcome to Feels Like Weezer, where we're going track by track, song by song, through Weezer's catalog, from the Blue Album all the way to Van Weezer.
Van Weezer!
I almost said Black Album.
That's like, oh, right, yeah.
Yes. We just recently announced this past week or so ago, as of when we're recording this.
Right, yeah.
And Van Weezer album was announced, and they even put out the first song from it, first single, what have you.
Which is...
Soundin' Bitchin'.
Super great. I loved it.
Video for it too, even, and the whole announcement of the tour next summer,
Hell Omega
tour with Fallout Boy and Green Day.
How much do you think tickets are going to be for that?
I feel like I thought I saw some numbers, but maybe there are just people guessing.
Yeah, well, they go up for sale in a couple days from us recording this. They should already be for sale.
Okay, already. Wow.
Ear listeners right now.
Oh, yeah, but yeah, for the people listening. Yep. Yeah. Okay, and by the way, who are we? I'm Eric Nash from Almost Famous Minute. Let's get right over
and,
there.
And, oh, yeah,
so,
yeah.
So
you,
excited.
Yeah, right? Well, I mean, Van Weezer was pretty exciting. And I'm Zach Frankensmith. You can follow me on Twitter at The Informal Log. So how's do we want to talk about Van Weezer, or do we want to talk about Pink Triangle? Which one do we want to do?
It might be preferable to continue talking about Van Weezer. We got many years ago until we're really, really there.
Right. Oh, boy. We'll be old and gray by then.
Hey, speak for yourself. I already am.
Oh, well. You beat me to the punch there, Eric.
That left you speechless.
It was just a little, I don't know what to say here. Yeah, how's it going, buddy?
Yeah, I'm pretty good.
And oh, yeah.
Yourself?
Living the dream. Oh, man. Let me tell you. Worked out my quads. lifting some books. It was great. What song are we talking about?
Yeah, as you already mentioned, Pink Triangle. When I'm stable.
Yes.
From Pinkerton?
After our recording with Robin, I think it was, when he was like, oh, track number four, where you just like, oh, man, I don't want to do this, and it was Why Bother? I'm like, I don't know what that is, because I couldn't remember the track listing in my head.
Yeah, right, yeah.
I grabbed the CD, and it's propped up, so I can see
right
the track
there.
Listing.
Ready?
Yeah. So, yes, that is number eight, Eric. And the third single as well.
Yeah, right. Well, and the way I was reading it, it almost seems like it was like kind of like a half single-ish, you know? It didn't,
right.
it went out for radio airplay, but wasn't really that easy to buy or something, maybe?
Is that the case? they didn't do a retail single for this one. And the radio didn't really play it a whole lot because, you know, oh no, LGBT. Yeah. Oh no.
They were so ahead of their time.
What's funny is that, like,
as long as you're not saying it in a negative way, which, you know,
right.
It's a little bit negative what he's saying.
And that's the thing. It's like, you know, it's really ahead of its time for, you know, talking about those, you know, LGBT things. Mm-hmm. And then also, like, listening to it in 2019, we're just like, okay, we don't talk like that anymore. But yeah, this song.
He's not saying, hey, she's a dumb lesbian. He's saying, I'm
right,
dumb.
Yeah,
she's
at least
a lesbian.
Can we put that on a shirt?
Putting herself down.
Yeah, I mean, at least there's that, I guess. But at the same time, like, okay, let's talk here, Rivers. Yeah. Let's maybe not get upset because, you know, the girl you like is a lesbian.
And okay, so let's say it here. I mean, this is very pretty famously, I think. And I think it's, I mean, in my own personal way, when you know, a few years ago now, when I wasn't as into Weezer as I've gotten more so, and haven't listened to this album as quite as much, but I'd heard things, and this was like the one of the most common tracks to hear something about, and mm-hmm. it being delved into a little bit about how he's saying he's relating the story that actually took place to him, and he's changing some kind of facts around a little bit, you know, here and there, mm-hmm. but the general idea is something seemingly the way he felt.
Yeah.
When this event took place and when he was in college.
Oh yeah. Well, and it's, I mean, in my younger days, it's happened to me as well. So, you know, again, high school Zach loved this album, you know, it was because it just, there's so much that relates to that age range, you know, and I think that this especially is, you know, it's a situation that a lot of people find themselves in, and it's just like, you know, and we're seeing that in pop culture too. It's becoming more, you know, like, well, don't be, you can still be friends with this woman who is a lesbian. Mm-hmm. Just, you know, like that's my thing, you know, when people are like, oh man, she broke my heart, and it's like, well, she can't really help it, you know. it's not her fault.
Well, for a second there I thought you were almost gonna say, and I almost thought to say jump in, but with the idea that you find out she's a lesbian but you still got the hots for her anyway.
Well, see, that's, yeah, yep. It's just how, you know, like, it, and it's weird, you know, it's like, that's especially how young guys are wired, mm-hmm. you know, especially in high school. It's like, oh my God, when you discover that, you're like, I just want to, anything that moves, you know, it's like, mm-hmm. let's go, let's do this. But it's like, let's pump the brakes here, Rivers. All right. So the song in general, I mean, it's a pretty good song, you know.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, I think, yeah, there's stuff going on in it that is very catchy and to the point that there's a song that has been played in my church for like the past, this whole summer, essentially, I think. Uh-huh. It was played like almost every Sunday, if not every Sunday, for it's a very short part, you know, short part of a song, or a short song itself. Mm-hmm. Just go in or out of a certain prayer section or what have you. But there was just this one part where it's like, man, that sounds familiar. That doesn't sound familiar. Finally, by like the fourth time out of 20 times now that I've heard it, I realized what it was. So then I definitely couldn't get out of my head the further 16 times I heard it over the course of mm-hmm. the summer, roughly. But and what the song is, I can't even tell you. I'd have to go back and look it up. But I mean, it is that, I think that most, you know, that most the chorus part, you know, the melody mm-hmm. of that how he sings, and I think the, you know, the, whether it's the chords and or notes that are played by probably guitar, you know, mainly guitar, mm-hmm. are picking out that melody as well, it's the very beginning, you know, the very beginning of the chorus. I don't know that it's mm-hmm. the whole chorus, but it's at least that. Definitely the I'm dumb, she's a lesbian.
Yeah.
The melody that goes along with that.
Which, that's the only part of the song that I, like, understood, is the chorus.
Mm-hmm. You know, oh, yeah. Like, well, yeah, and there's only little parts, just little couple words here and there throughout, like, the first verse especially.
Mm-hmm. Where I can understand.
Oh, really?
Second verse, like, maybe the second half of the second verse that mm-hmm. I got, but the first half, like, the first four lines, I'm like, I don't. Reading this for the first time, I'm like, oh, okay. That's it. That's what he says. Uh-huh. But it's got some... What I really like about this song in particular is that how the meter of how he's talking or singing is. See a sweet and floral print. My mind begins the arrangements, and how he does that. You know, I know that you're breaking it out by syllable, but still, like... it's a really cool meter, I guess. Mm-hmm. Huh. I'm gonna edit that together to make it sound like I made a point there, but like, this is the, you know, like earlier when I was doing, you know, my research for this. That's like, this is the first time I actually found out what some of these lyrics are.
Yeah.
So, like that, the floral print and arrangements line, really, the first two lines of the first verse, the chorus, and the second half of the second verse, that's all I knew about this song. Mm-hmm. But,
well, yeah, well, there's something in the second verse I'd really like to point out.
Go for it.
So, it ends with the, everyone's a little queer, oh, can't she be a little straight? And that's, yeah, and that's one of the main sticking points, I feel like, that, you know, a few years ago when I kind of heard maybe a similar, you know, not podcast, but something else on, maybe on radio, on NPR, maybe, or something, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
But, so, compare that, you then look at the very beginning of this verse. Might have smoked a few in my time. So that, for a little bit, you know, like, I mean, in coming to this recording, and thinking about this song more in depth than I ever had before, that's for sure. I wasn't totally sure if I was gonna totally take that euphemism, for what it is. But I just finally dawned on me a couple of days ago. It's like, okay, it's got to be it. It's got to be, you know, he's got to be talking about himself performing oral sex.
Oh, for sure.
On a guy.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Oh totally.
Yeah, having a homosexual act, and that's why he then talks about everyone's a little queer, you know.
Right.
Because he himself apparently has been a little queer.
Well, you know, good for him.
Yeah. Oh yeah, and I certainly don't begrudge it. I know there's are great friends.
Come on, Eric. We all know that. Oh, yeah. But yeah, it's a nice little song. The music's good. I think it's that one song that everybody, when you talk about Pinkerton, like, this is, I think, mm-hmm, the song everybody talks about. Yeah. I would say it's the most memorable, I think, for them, which is funny because like the single just bombed. Like, mm-hmm, it did not do well. Like, they didn't release it for, for retail and all that. But it's just, yeah, it's okay. I think that it's, you know, it is problematic, but at the same time, like, what isn't problematic? I think it's the least, mm-hmm, of the songs that are problematic, the least. So, you know, it's definitely no Across the Sea when it comes to that. So, look, man, I don't care what you do with your envelope, all right?
Another, though, here, another old cultural thing, though, that I think we need to point out. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, I think you were talking a little bit about some more current cultural, you know, whether movies or TV shows and being so much more LGBT friendly. But the one at the same time, I mean, it was something in the air, it was a kismet kind of what have you thing, and we've certainly talked about the writer director before, Kevin Smith, with his movie, mm-hmm, Chasing Amy, that had essentially a plot line that fairly well was quite similar to what's going on here.
Yeah. And they didn't know. And neither of them.
Yeah, right.
What was going on?
It took while until after each came out.
Until right. Yeah. That's interesting. You know. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's kind of like, yeah, you know, the Kennedy Lincoln thing, those, mm-hmm, connections where it's just a, you know, you put 1,000 things together, eventually, yeah, it's gonna, you know, you're gonna end up with the same thing eventually. But, mm-hmm, yeah, it's that's cool though, because it's, and especially in, you know, 96, 97, when this was released, you know, like, that was when we didn't talk about that kind of stuff, you know, as a culture, mm-hmm, you know, and I mean, I was 4 or 5 at the time, so I can't really speak too much to that, but, you know, looking at media from then, it's, you know, you're using, a lot of times they would use homosexuality as a punchline, you know, mm-hmm, instead of a genuine character trait. Which I also find it interesting that Chasing Amy is the least well-received of Kevin Smith's movies. Isn't it?
I don't know about least. No.
Okay, maybe I'm thinking of a different one.
Boy. The Mallrats is the one that bombed the most, probably, I would say. Right. Of his, say, his first two-thirds-ish career.
Mm-hmm. But I mean, that had a very niche audience. Like, let's be honest.
Yeah.
Weezer fans and other mm-hmm. virgins. But, yeah. Commercially, I feel like there was a lot more of a cult to Mallrats, though.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
You know.
Yeah, it's definitely gained a lot more status,
mm-hmm.
you know, than it initially had.
Well, and now, like, even in Captain Marvel, Stan Lee's cameo was a reference to Mallrats, which I thought was just amazing. Like, that was a wonderful little bit there. But, yeah, because it was Clerks, that, and Dogma, and Chasing Amy. If I remember right, everybody makes fun of Chasing Amy. Or is there something else?
No, I'm pretty sure, yeah, I went from Chasing Amy to Dogma.
Mm-hmm. Which, come on, that's such a great movie.
Yeah, I think both of those really, even though there was certainly... There was the LGBT issue with Chasing Amy.
Mm-hmm.
There's the religious issue with Dogma.
What?
But they both...
There is?
You know, and I think they both... certainly got some people's ires up.
I can't see why.
But they, I think they've
right.
gone on to also, you know, be pretty well regarded.
Mm-hmm.
And I would say even Chase right. and Amy more so at the time had a bit more better regard.
Oh, okay.
Of say all three of these after post Clerks.
All right, Zach, cut that whole five-minute section out. But at least around my household, Chasing Amy was always the joke.
Really?
It. You know, like, nobody wants to watch that one. But so I guess maybe that just says something about my family. Jeez. Terrible. You know, I find it interesting that that's, you know... Like, mm-hmm. two pretty popular things, you know, specifically aimed at people who are kind of notorious for not being as accepting. You know, mm-hmm. you've got your, with this, it's, you know, young white men
right.
with Pinkerton, and also your nerds. With that, and then also with Chasing Amy as well, like Kevin Smith was kind of like a nerdy director, you know. And I don't know if you know this, but nerds like to gatekeep people. I don't know if you've ever been a part of nerd culture. Like, I'm sorry, you didn't know the name of all the starfighters in Star Wars? Get out of here, you know. You know, I find it very interesting that's, you know, like two mm-hmm. directors essentially did something, you know, the same thing for groups of people talking about how it's okay. Marginalized groups are good people, sort of. You know, I think Pinkerton less so, but, you know, I think it's one of those where if you read into the subtext a bit, he, you know, like, obviously he's down about it, but, you know, he's trying to reconcile it in his head, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I was saying things there.
Yep.
We'll fix it in post.
Do we want to move on a little more into the music part?
Yeah, for sure.
We have the killer solo in the middle, and then mm-hmm. I love the transition to it being a little on the quieter side. Not quite as quiet, especially as the way it starts and ends. It's almost a Christmassy, almost the baby rock
pie,
you know, a little mixture between the two things. Is the way it starts and ends.
I just imagine, like, jingle bells in the background.
Yeah.
You know. I mean, Pat Wilson on the drums during that little bit, too. Oh, my God. Like, the drums, I normally don't notice that kind of stuff, but, oh, man. I loved his little, you know, transitional bit there. But, yeah, the music is really good, and how it starts off that, you know, that really great, you know, boing, I guess. I'm trying to think, like, what you would call it. Is a note, the note he plays, you know, the right at the beginning. Mm-hmm. Like that, oh, that's so good. That's, to me, that's iconic. Mm-hmm. But, yeah, you know, overall, you know, the music is, like we have said pretty much for every song, like, if you don't listen to the lyrics, these are really good songs.
So that's something I was thinking about, and maybe I should save it for the Pinkerton recap episode.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, I don't know, you can go for it.
Okay,
go for it.
It's just, what would your take be on someone, whether it's Rivers or someone else, you know, not doing a funny parody redo on any or all of the songs from this album, you know, but more mm-hmm. of a with some lyrics that are, you know, more
less misogynistic.
Yeah, right.
Like if instead of Tired of Sex we do Tired of Sax and we talk about Kenny G, is that what you're saying?
I would, like, be 100% there for much it. Like Weird Al, so
right.
Same from that, but you know. But changing it to lyrics that are more normal,
kind of updating it to you know, a modern day. Mm-hmm. I think it would be much better, you know. But overall, you know, structurally, the album is great. You know, mm-hmm. like the music and all that is fantastic. But you know, you're right. I think that if Rivers were to go and kind of look at Pinkerton and what message he's trying to purvey, you know, because a lot of this album is about, you know, love and lust and sexuality, you know, I think now as an adult, he has a much better grasp on that. And so I would really be interested to see what he could come up with that post, you know, marriage. Mm-hmm. Like how that would change his viewpoint, because out of all of the stuff that they play live, I think Pink Triangle is the only one from Pinkerton they do regularly. Mm-hmm. But I don't know, I could be wrong about that. I think it would make me like the album a little bit more, but I don't think anybody else would enjoy that.
Would it be one point in the rating, or two or three or something? See, that you'd automatically increase roughly?
Really what it would be is it would just say Pinkerton the Zach edition, yeah, in parentheses on the side. But yeah, I mean, I think that it would kind of boost it up a little bit, you know, in esteem. I think that I could then be at that point where everybody else is about Pinkerton, where they think it's so great and wonderful and everything. I think I could get to that point, mm-hmm. if the lyrics were different. You know, I think that that's a big thing for me, especially. But yeah, I mean, the music, like I said, is just top notch. You know, I think that this is Rivers at his musical creative best. Until everything will be all right. Okay.
I was gonna say,
because everything will be it's just so good from beginning to end. I never skip a song on White's a Baby. We'll get there. I was putting the words together, letters together. I don't know. You got anything else about this one, Eric?
I think that's really pretty much it. Yeah.
Yeah. So, do you have any covers?
I have, from the source I've been using, no covers for this. Oddly enough, despite it sounding like it would be perfectly suitable, at least from the very beginning, you know, the first 5 seconds and the last 5 seconds, suitable for the Rockabye Baby. But not mm-hmm. even that. However,
there's no great Christmas version of that.
There is certainly there's one thing that was listed there. It's as far as remixes go. There's
there's
a guy, Tom Lord Alge, ALGE.
Mm-hmm.
Algie.
Sure.
and it's Lord LORD-ALGE. But, you know, and I didn't seek that out, but, you know, that's out there for people to possibly listen to. Maybe I shall right. soon, but.
Well, and there's an acoustic version of this song, too, from yeah. them. Like, it's a live acoustic mm-hmm. version that was played in high school. So a student at the school won a radio contest to have them play, you know, like one of those things where, you know. Like that when Taylor Swift did that kind of thing where it's like, okay, if whatever school gets the most votes, well, I'll go play at that. And then she got voted to go to a school for the deaf.
Oh, really?
Did you hear about that? No, like that happened a few years ago.
That's a funny little bit of trolling there.
Right. You know, but I mean, and she ended up turning it into, you know, something positive. But yeah. No, apparently in this one. In this version, you can hear, like, every time that he says lesbian, everybody's like, oh, yeah, mm-hmm. you know, because it's a bunch of high school kids. So, and that is on the promo CD that they did for radio. So, which is interesting that they put a live track for a single like that, you know, I don't know. Anyway, mm-hmm. maybe it's not weird, but. So what's your rating, buddy?
I just think it's so, especially that chorus is so catchy.
Mm-hmm.
I'm gonna give this a 9.
Ooh, I like boy!
It well,
yeah, really?
That's
the highest you've given this album, isn't it?
This album. At this point, we'll see if the next two tracks could possibly beat it.
The next two tracks are pretty baller. Like, I'm not gonna lie. I mean, they're no The Good Life, but I, against my better judgment, I'm gonna give this probably a 7.
Mm-hmm.
Like it is just such a great tune, and you know it's fun to sing along to, and of course, you know, like I can relate to it from when I was in high school and all that, and it's you know, it's overall it's a pretty good song. Yes, there are some problems with it, but I mean, it's Weezer, let's be honest. It's Weezer, you know, pre-marriage, so yeah.
So that's going to be it, I think, for this episode, covering Pink Triangle. We'll be back for Falling for You, coming up on Tuesday.
Buddy.
But until then, Zach, where can people find you?
You can find me in your nightmares. why haven't we made that joke yet? That was terrible. That was a bad joke. But you can find me.
We are in October now, so.
Oh, yes.
The scary month.
It's scary. Bigotry. Ooh. You can find me on Twitter at The Informal Log. I probably have changed my profile picture to something spooky at this point. So, or, you know, at your local library.
Yeah. And you can find me. I have my personal account at Lucky Mustard on Twitter and Lucky Mustardine on Instagram. And, I also have my couple other podcasts I have done in the past, Watch My Minute, but should be coming back here in just a week or two from now.
Oh, yeah, maybe.
Because of the HBO show, Watchmen.
So we'll excited.
Do a little recap episode after each. Probably have it out the next day or so after. Shouldn't take too long, I don't think. Mr. Travis Bill and I will do. But then currently you should also be able to hear Almost Famous Minute.
And where can you find that, Eric?
Yes, you can find Almost Famous Minute and Feels Like Weezer on the Pantheon Podcast Network. It covers rock and roll in all kinds of forms, from things like my other show there, the movie that deals a lot with rock and roll, rock music, but then also things like there's The Career Musician that the host over there delves into. Musicians that have pretty strong careers in the business, not just your little jam bands and stuff.
Right. There's also the Shout It Out Loud cast, yeah. which I love Kiss. And I think that we really should try to do a crossover with them because, let's be honest, I mean, Rivers was so influenced by Kiss. I think it's just a great opportunity. Also, I bring this up because I moved a lot of books today. So, but one of the books, we you know those like, so you're at Target. You probably don't see these, but you know, I call them bobblehead biographies. Well, my youth librarian calls them bobblehead biographies. They're the who is, what is, where is those books. Mm-hmm. Do you kind of know what I'm talking about?
Not exactly, but I can imagine.
You can imagine what they look like. Yeah. There's one for What is Rock and Roll? Mm-hmm. And, you know, I flip through it and everything. And Kiss gets a whole section. They talk about the Foo Fighters, Bush, Nirvana, Soundgarden.
Oh, no. But no Weezer?
Not a mention of Weezer. And it's like, excuse me, you wouldn't have your My Chemical Romances without Weezer. So let's send this back to publishing here. All right, get your writer back on the horn. So check out my book coming out. Who is Rivers Cuomo? but yeah, no, I get annoyed about that kind of stuff. But yes, check all of the wonderful podcasts out on Pantheon. Another?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, you got another one?
Well, the other one that just covered Weezer. Who cares about the Rock Hall?
Yeah.
You should definitely check out that episode from mid-September.
Oh my. And they're going to be doing, there is a Ratitude episode coming out on Make It Stop, which is about bad music. So
probably coming out right about the same time this is, roughly.
Yeah. Yeah. Close. Take that, Condra. Yeah. Her episode's been released. Yeah. Take that. Everybody else thinks it's garbage. Stop liking Ratitude. It's not good. You can listen to this podcast and all other podcasts on pantheonpodcast.com.
Okay,
did you like that radio voice?
Oh,
I did.
Yeah, it was wonderful.
This is NPR. Welcome to This American Life. I'm Ira Glass.
Okay, so Ira, we'll be back next time with Flying for You.